so much. What am I working with? Oh, that, it's already starting. How are you guys doing, Lakewood? Lakewood Young Adults. How awesome was that conference? Amazing. Like Pastor Nick said, I have had the privilege of being at 7 out of the 9. I would have been at 9 out of the 9, except me and my wife have 4 kids. And a couple of those, we had just had babies, because we love not only having babies, we love practicing. And so I missed two out of the 9, but I have been here for 7. And I promise you guys, I am not blowing smoke when I say this. This last one was just extra special. They have all been incredible, but there was something so special on this last one. And number 10 is going to be number 10. It's even going to be better. So not only do you have to be here with us next year, but you got to bring a whole bunch of people, especially if you're like me and from out of town, man. There is something so special happening at Lakewood Church. How many of you, by show of hands, actually attend Lakewood Church? All right, okay, all right, I gotta talk to you for a minute, and this is serious, because you don't know what it's like to be a visitor here, if you've been going here for a very long time. And when us visitors, when we walk into this place, I think we sense something that if you guys aren't careful, you can kind of forget. In fact, the Bible says this, it says that familiarity breeds contempt. We have to be so careful, and here's why I say that. There is something so beautifully unfamiliar about what's happening at Lakewood Church. And I know when you get into it week after week, Sunday mornings, Wednesday nights, Sunday nights, it can start to feel familiar and you can start to just expect what God is doing in this place. But there is something so divine. God's thumbprint on Lakewood Church for decades now has been otherworldly and divine. And so would you just, every time you get a chance to walk into this place, would you just thank God that He sent you to Lakewood Church and thank God for your leaders? Pastor Joel and Pastor Victoria are blessings, not just to Houston, but to literally the whole body of Christ on the globe. God raised Pastor Joel up to be an apostle of hope. And I don't use the word apostle as lightly as we do very often, but I want to always make sure I say that. God raises up apostles all over the world, men and women, to teach us about different parts of His character. And for whatever reason, He saw fit to choose Pastor Joel Osteen to be the apostle to teach the body of Christ to have relentless hope. And I've my whole life, the biggest thorn in my flesh has been a struggle with depression. Some of you, you know what that's like. And there is nothing on planet Earth more important when you struggle with depression than hope. It's the ultimate medicine. There is nothing like it. And so I was sitting in church just this morning, listening to your pastor preach, and I was just getting filled up. This whole conference, I was just getting filled up. On Friday night, by the time Friday night happened, Pastor Mike Todd had me, a 45-year-old grown man, at a youth and young adult conference. I was the first guy down at the altar, bawling like a little schoolgirl. The only time I opened my eyes was to wipe them because of all the tears, and there were a couple junior high girls looking at me like I was a creeper guy. Like, are you all right? And I'm like, not now. God's given me peace. All right, back it up. Back it up, all right? So I just simply want to say this. It's such an honor to be here. And every time I come here, God does something so special. And I actually believe that He's going to do something surprisingly special tonight. I don't care if you're tired. It's fine. God does amazing work when we're weak. I think I read a scripture about it, right? In our weakness, His power is made perfect. So I feel like I got the best slot here. I feel like God's going to surprise some people tonight with what He's going to do. I'm red, bold, and fired up, right? So we're going to do this. We're going to pray, because you don't need to hear a talk from Chad Bruegman. I'm nothing. I'm nobody. But you do want to hear from God. And so we're going to invite His Holy Spirit to do what only His Holy Spirit could do. Would you just put your hands out in a receiving posture real quick? Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your goodness. Heavenly Father, we thank You that You are kind, and it's Your kindness that leads us to change. Heavenly Father, we thank You that You aren't mad at one single person in the sound of my voice. God, we thank You, like it says in John 3:17, You didn't come to condemn us. You came to save us. We don't take that lightly. Holy Spirit, would You do what only You can do, which is counsel us tonight and help us and inspire us. But more than anything, Holy Spirit, what You mainly do is You point to the beauty of God's Son, Jesus. So would You do that one more time in this conference? May we finish better than we started. And it's in your name we pray. And everyone said, amen. Amen. You guys can go ahead and be seated. I want to do this. I want to speak from one scripture verse tonight, if you guys are okay with that. I'm a pretty simple person, and I usually can't take in too much more than that. So I just said I'm going to speak on one particular verse, and I'm just going to talk about it and talk about it and talk about it until I see your faces and go, I think they're starting to get some of this, all right? This verse is found in the book of James, chapter 3. I believe it's verse 18, and the apostle James, he says this, and I love this statement. It fires me up. He says, peacemakers, everybody say peacemakers, because that's what I'm going to talk to us about tonight. Peacemakers who sow in peace, listen to this, this is a promise, will raise a harvest of righteousness. Peacemakers who sow in peace will raise a harvest of righteousness. If you're taking notes, I've titled this message this evening this. I've titled it, Move In. And here's why. There's a psychologist who I love. I started reading her books about 3 or 4 years ago. And a couple years ago, my wife on vacation handed me one of her books and says, this is the next one you got to read. It's unbelievable. And another reason I love this lady is because she happens to be a local here in Houston. Her name is Brené Brown. Any of you heard of her? Incredible psychologist, and she has so many good things to say. But in chapter 4 of this book called Braving the Wilderness, the title is this, and this is where I got our title, Move In. Brené Brown says this, people are hard to hate, close up, move in. I'm gonna read that again, because this is what it means to be a peacemaker. Peacemakers love this. People are hard to hate, close up, so move in. And I love that Brené wrote that, but can I tell you who started that idea? Jesus. Jesus was the ultimate at moving in. You guys realize that. You realize he was on a throne in the heavenly realms, right? Sitting in absolute perfection. And for whatever reason, he decided to put on an earth suit and subject himself to all of the struggle and all of the pain and all of the sin that you and I have to sit through every single day. And you know why he did that? He came here to say, I don't hate you. I'm not mad at you. I got nothing but love for you, to quote MC Heavy D. I got nothing but love for you, right? That's what he came to do. He didn't come to condemn us. He came to save us. Jesus was the king at moving in. In fact, John chapter 1 verse 14 says this, the word became flesh and blood, and I love this, and moved in to the neighborhood. Jesus, the word became flesh and blood, and he moved in to the neighborhood. He was king at moving in. My favorite, probably my favorite story in all of the gospels is Jesus with the woman at the well. You guys, come on, if you've been in church for more than 2 minutes, you're familiar with that incredible account. I love that because that's a story ultimately of Jesus moving in to show this really hurt and this really broken and this really vulnerable lady who was supposed to be Jesus's enemy because of the different colors of their pigment. And because of the national hostility between the Jews and the Samaritans. You understand that? In fact, there was so much enmity and so much hostility between Jesus and, or excuse me, between the Jews and the Samaritans, that the Jews literally built a road around Samaria so they could, quote unquote, keep the peace and walk around it instead of walking into the middle of it and stirring up trouble. But here's the problem. Jesus isn't a peacekeeper. He's a peacemaker. This world doesn't need any peacekeepers. If we had perfect peace, then we'd preach messages about peacekeeping. If everyone in this room was at perfect peace with themselves, then I would come up here and give a message on how to maintain peace. But our world hasn't had that since we took the bite out of the apple, right? You understand that. Jesus isn't a peacekeeper. Make no mistake about it. Jesus is a peacemaker. You understand that? And there's a big difference between being a peacekeeper and being a peacemaker. And the minute that Jesus walks right into the middle of Samaria instead of around it, he's saying, I'm not a peacekeeper. Peacekeepers walk around the problem and act like it's not there. I'm a peacemaker. I'm coming to fix the problem. And what I love about Jesus is he then looks at us and says, you want to go too? You want to be my disciple too? You want to start coming into alignment with me and the way my kingdom does stuff? And guess what? We can go start some holy trouble together. Because make no mistake about it, Lakewood young adults, peacemaking is anything but crazy. Peacemaking is holy troublemaking. Do you understand that? Peacemaking isn't passive. Peacemaking isn't for the faint of heart. You want to be a peacemaker in this house tonight? And I prayed up and said, God, I'm going to go into this message believing every single person you brought here tonight in your sovereignty wants in the deepest parts of who they are to be a peacemaker, not a peacekeeper. I'm sick of living in a nation full of peacekeepers. I'm sick of peacekeepers just tribing up and going to their safe spaces where they're just going to stick with people that look like them and think like them and vote like them and are the same color as them and think the same way and are a part of the same religion as each other, and we're just going to tribe up, and to keep the peace, we're going to play it safe. And Jesus said, I didn't come to do that. I came to disrupt the peace. Long before Jesus said, my peace I leave you, my peace I give you, years before that, do you remember what else he said? I didn't come to bring peace, I came to bring a sword. I came to stir up some holy trouble so eventually I can leave this place with peace. But if you're going to be a peacemaker, you have to understand that everywhere Jesus went making peace, he just kept getting in trouble. You ever go to church and get permission to get in trouble? Because that's what I'm here to do tonight. I'm here to give you permission. I know a bunch of young adults, you want to, but you're like repressing it. And you're like, I'm not allowed. No, I'm telling you, there is a holy way to get in some trouble. And it's being a peacemaker. Because peacemakers don't walk around the problems. Peacemakers walk right in the middle of it. Jesus walks right into the middle of Samaria. And he sits with the least unlikely person. Not only was she a Samaritan. Bad move there, Jesus. But she's a Gentile. And she's a female. And you know what Jesus is at this point in the story? He's a rabbi. Everyone's calling him rabbi. And you know what happens to a rabbi who walks into Samaria and sits with a woman at the well? They become ceremonially unclean. You know how inconvenient it was for a priest to become ceremonially unclean? But guess what? Peacemakers don't care about convenience. Peacekeepers care greatly about convenience. You know what? Peacemakers don't give a rip about convenience. They give a rip about fixing some problems in the name of Jesus and for the glory of Jesus. And I think this room wants to be that. I can just sense it. I can just feel it. So he walks right into the middle and he sits with her. And this would be one of the first of many things that he would do that would be the catalyst to take him to the cross. This would be one of the things that was so disruptive to the religious system of the day, Lakewood Church, that it would ultimately be a catalyst for getting Jesus put on the cross. You understand that? See, peacemakers, you know what they do? They walk right into the middle of problems. Peacekeepers walk around them. Remember the story about the woman caught in adultery? Another story that's just incredible. I love this because Jesus, if he was a peacekeeper, do you know what he would have done? He would have seen the commotion downtown. He would have seen a really bad situation where he knows a woman is possibly about to get stoned to death. And he would have looked and he would have walked the other way and said, you know what? I don't want to see that. That's too hard to handle. Because the minute I see some men stoning a woman for making a mistake, I have to be accountable to the fact that I'm okay with that. So what peacekeepers do is when they see trouble brewing, you know what they do? They walk away so they don't have to be accountable. You know what peacemakers do? And I think you all want to be peacemakers. I can feel it in my bones. You know what peacemakers do? They get right in front of the person and say, hit me first. No one was more innocent in that place than Jesus. No one had the right more to walk away and go, I'm cool. I'm sinless. I'm divine. I'm from heaven, straight up. And you know what he does? He sees this woman. He sees this woman in the most vulnerable position of her life, and he stands right in front of her. And you know what he does before he knows her resume? Do you know what he does before he speaks into her adulterous affair? Do you know what he does before he points the finger at her and says, shame on you? He doesn't do any of that. He just defends her. Because that's what godly peacemakers do. They defend before they disciple. Jesus is God. He's earned the right to do whatever he wants, and he still is giving us the model of, no, you earn your discipleship, leaders. You earn your right to speak into someone's life if you really want them to change. And so what Jesus does is save her life publicly, defends her publicly, and then privately says, now let's disciple. Don't commit adultery. You almost got us both killed. Come on, like, stop that. I didn't just arbitrarily put that in the Ten Commandments, sweetheart. I picture him saying that. He's like, I was trying to keep you from getting killed. You understand that? But he does all of that privately, but in front of the masses, do you know what he does? He stirs up some holy trouble. Because this was a huge catalyst to ultimately get Jesus crucified. What about when he's walking by one day? And there's a tax collector, and Jesus has got a huge following. His crew's with him, right? The people that want to hang with Jesus, because he's just got this knack to raise people from the dead and touch their eyes. And who doesn't want to be around Jesus until Jesus stirs up some holy trouble and does what he's not supposed to do according to the rules? You know what he does? He looks at Matthew and says, "Hey, Matt." And everyone immediately would have went, "Oh, we just think it's a nice Sunday school moment where Jesus calls Matthew." And everyone there would have gasped, because when he said, "Hey, Matt, you want to come and be my disciple?" Everyone there would have lost their minds. Because if you've ever read the Gospels before, do you notice that there's categories of people? And in the Gospels, repeatedly, there's sinners, then tax collectors. That's bad when you got your own category, right? We know we're all sinners, but it's like there's sinners and then there's tax collectors. No one's worse than that. Because what Matthew was doing was he was of Jewish DNA. There's nothing worse than this. And he's robbing from his own family and friends. He's extorting in the name of Rome from his family and friends, who are already poor and oppressed nation, so that he could get rich quick and Rome would say, "Cool, Matthew." So nobody was hated more. Nobody was more the scum of the earth in first century Judea in their own community than the tax collectors. So when Jesus says, "Matt, you want to come and be my disciple?" Everyone would have lost their minds, especially the first three disciples he called, because you know what they were? Fishermen. And I picture Peter being like, "Jesus, our life group right now is awesome. You can't do this. You're breaking up the mojo, man. We got something going on here, right? Life group's awesome when everyone's a fisherman, but then all of a sudden Jesus goes, yeah, we're going to add a tax collector." And now all of a sudden life group just got real, right? Where am I at, leaders? Now you got a real fun job. But you know what Jesus is trying to do more than have a neat, fun, safe life group? He's trying to raise up some peacemakers. And because peacemakers who sow in peace raise a harvest of righteousness. And if I read the Bible right, we serve a harvest God. We serve a God that constantly uses language of harvest, and he constantly says, "And I want you to be a part of it." Like the sweet spot in life is when you go into the world and you're a part of the harvest. And so he calls what about the lepers? How often? And I hope I'm driving home the point here, because I think we have some peacemakers in the room. What about how often this rabbi did the ultimate rabbinical no-no, and he would continually walk up to lepers? I can't imagine all his crew going, "Jesus, please don't. Like, this is your, first of all, you could get leprosy. Second of all, this is going to make you ceremonially unclean. Third of all, the religious leaders are going to lose their minds because you're breaking, and then you're going to go and do it on the Sabbath. Come on, Jesus, you know you can't touch those lepers." But that's peacekeeping mentality, because you know what peacekeepers think? Around people that are sent, and we still do this in modern America, we still send people to the outskirts. We still send, and we don't say it, but we still put people on the outskirts and say, "You're unclean. You can't be around because of your issue, because of your thing," right? And Jesus walks right up to those people that we put into those categories, and he just says, "What do you need? What do you want?" And if they want to be healed, he lovingly touches them. And here's the peacekeeper mindset. Jesus, you can't touch them because you might get leprosy. And here's the peacemaker mindset. I've got to go and touch them because they might get Jesus. Right? And peacemakers who sow in peace raise a harvest of righteousness. James never said peacekeepers who sow peacekeeping. You know what they raise? A harvest of safety. Now, that doesn't sound fun to me. I want to stir some trouble on this side of heaven. You remember after you breathe your last, if you're a believer, there's no more death, no more mourning, no more crying, no more pain, for the old order of things will have passed away. But on this side of eternity, Nick said it Wednesday night, we're going to stir up some trouble. We're going to have some trouble, but be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. That's Jesus going, go be a troublemaker. Don't just get in trouble. Go make some trouble. Be proactive. Go be a peacemaker. Peacekeepers who sow peacekeeping raise a harvest of safety. And I think C.S. Lewis said it first, but I'm going to give Andy Mineo credit because I like the way he says it better. My God's good, but he's not safe. God's a lot of things, but I think sometimes we think safety is more important than God does on this side of eternity. God's like, no. And this is why he always raises up a group of young people in a new generation. It's because people like me, we start to get old, we start to get boring, we start to play things safe. We start to get nervous. We start to get tired. And so God looks at the next generation like you and says, I know I got some peacemakers in here. You want to go? Let's go. Because God doesn't get tired and God doesn't get scared. And he's calling a bunch of you, not only in here, but whoever's listening online, to be peacemakers. But it's not for the faint of heart. Listen to me. If you want to be a peacemaker, not just a peacekeeper, it's going to punish you sometimes. I want to tell you the truth before you say amen. Some of your hearts are starting to go, I think I'm that person. I just want to sober us up and make sure we remember this. Sometimes peacemaking is going to punish you. And that's not my opinion. It's sometimes my experience, but this is Jesus' story. He comes to create ultimate peace, and what's he get for it? Punished. It's not my opinion. It's the prophet Isaiah, right? The punishment that brought us peace was upon who? The ultimate peacemaker. You understand that? Like Jesus came to be a peacemaker knowing it was going to get him punished on the front end, but knowing that he would reign forever on the back end with the name above every name, that at that name, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that he's Lord. You want to talk about a harvest of righteousness? There has been billions of people who are in heaven right now for the last 2,000 years because Jesus was willing to stir up enough trouble to get punished to bring peace to people that needed peace. You want to talk about a harvest, it's unprecedented. There's no one in the history of the world that even remotely comes close to having the following and the harvest that has come from Jesus. And why? Because he came to bring peace. But with that, he got punished because he also brought a sword. And Jesus is saying to us, hey, I want you all, there's no better place than to be my disciple, but we're going to stir up some trouble. We're going to go to some places that other people won't go. We're going to get in some lives of some people we've been told we're not supposed to hang out with. We're going to speak up for those who can't speak for themselves, because that's what men and women of God do. I learned about this peacemaking, this whole peacemaking thing from an unsuspected person. I speaking of moved in, since we called this message moving in 2008, my wife and I, we moved in to our first home that we were able to buy. And I still don't think we could afford it, but we did it anyways, and we were super excited. But it was in a crazy neighborhood, because in Denver, the housing market's nuts, and we bought what we could afford, and it was not much. And we moved into this house, and we loved it, and we were so proud, and everything was going so good, and we got the loan approved, and the only thing that was holding us back was our neighbor. And it was a guy named Cliff and his dad, Chuck. And Cliff was a heroin addict and an alcoholic. And all of the houses were super old, but most of the people in the neighborhood at least had enough pride in themselves to take care of the yards to some degree. But Cliff and Chuck took no care of their yard. And they're the yard with all the cars in the front, but none of the cars work, you know what I'm saying? And I'm sitting there doing the math, and I'm thinking about my future, and I'm thinking about the resale value someday, and I'm going, did we make a mistake buying this house? Because something about those neighbors is crazy. I have two little kids at the time, so I'm also nervous just about the fact that we live next to a heroin addict and an alcoholic. But I move in, and the first day I move in, I'm in the work truck, and we had just pulled up, and I'm with some friends, and we're moving some stuff into the garage, and out comes Cliff, and he's hammered, and he's kind of walking like this, and he's got on ripped old jeans, he's got on work boots that have holes in the toes, I'm not kidding you, he's wearing no shirt, he's got a big old beer belly, he's got a nappy beard, it's not like hipster, I make coffee for a living beard, it's like janky, it's nasty, and he comes strolling out. And he's a littler fella, but he's got a powerful voice. And we're just moving, and I didn't even notice him. And all of a sudden, I hear this, hey. I go, yeah. And all kinds of thoughts running through my mind. He goes, you're not going to call the cops on me, are you? And my friends are looking at me. I go, I don't know. Should I? Am I? I don't know. You tell me what's going on here. But I started to realize, I know what he's saying. Whoever lived here before, thanks for not telling us. Apparently he gets the cops called on him all the time, because that's what happens to heroin and alcoholics, right? It's just, you know, stuff's going to start. And so I'm literally sitting there. My friends are looking at me like, I think you've made the single biggest, most expensive decision of your life, and you can't get out of it now, right? You've already signed 1,000 papers that you don't even know what they mean. And so I'm in and I'm sitting there going, oh dear God, this isn't cool. This isn't great. This is also a safety issue. And so I had a talk with Cliff a couple days later. And I said, listen, I'm going to do my best to be a good neighbor because it's part of my value system. I said, but I have two little kids and I'm not proud of this. But I said, if I ever see you get in your car inebriated, I'm going to kill you. I should not have said that, right? God's up there like, nope, start over, start over. That's not the holy troublemaking I'm talking about. No, 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 that's the world's way. But I said that, and I was so nervous. And I said that, and he kind of sobered up for a minute. It was like, he looked like he had a little respect for me for a second. I was like, okay. And then life went on, and I started talking to the other neighbors, and I started realizing there was a whole anti-Cliff neighborhood thing going on. We didn't have an HOA because we were an expensive enough neighborhood, but we had a Cliff OA where we all sat around and talked about, we sat around and talked about Cliff. And you ever have the neighbor where if they're outside, you'll be late for work before you'll go out and have to talk to them getting in your car? That's me and Cliff at this point. And then finally one day, listen to this, God's grace, because no one has taught me about peacemaking more than Cliff. I love how God works. One day I'm out mowing, and my five-year-old at the time would sit in our old Suburban we had, and I would put the windows down because it was hot out, and he would pretend like he's driving in my car while I'm mowing. And it was great. We had a great deal worked out because he's not in bugging mom. He's doing fine. I'm mowing the lawn, and I'm mowing, and I'm going down, and he's back there in the parking lot, and I turn around to mow the other way, and I see something that made my heart sink. Cliff, the drunk, is leaning over the window, and my son's holding on the steering wheel, and they're having a full-on conversation. And so I'm mowing like this, and I'm just looking right at him, and I'm going, don't you dare do anything to my son. I'm like mowing backwards like this, like... Right, I don't even know anymore if I have a straight line. I don't even care about my yard anymore, and that's a big deal for me. I'm just looking at him, and God starts speaking to my heart in the middle of this conversation between Cliff and a five-year-old. And I started to realize they're having a full-on legit conversation, and he had my son laughing, and they high-fived at one point. And I was sitting there going, I think Cliff is a five-year-old, like in here. And he was probably a 50-year-old man at the time. But I was like, I think he's like emotionally stunted, and therefore he's very uncomfortable with me, but very comfortable with my five-year-old. And I started for some reason to process that. And I started feeling grace for him. Because I had lived enough life and I had done this pastor thing and sat with people long enough to go, when people have stunted emotional growth like that, something profoundly painful happened to them as a kid. Wherever your emotional maturity is where something happened that stunted it if you don't get healed. And so I was like, I think I got to find out more about Cliff. And instead of now being annoyed and mad about Cliff and all of his antics, now all of a sudden I deeply cared and wanted to know his story. Because here's what peacemakers do. And I think I'm in a room of people that want to be peacemakers. Here's what peacemakers do. Peacemakers don't fixate on people's behavior. They fixate on people's backstory. You understand that? Peacemakers ask the questions that everybody else is too scared or indifferent or busy to ask other people that are hurting. Because behind every dysfunctional behavior, behind every behavior that your enemy annoys you with, there is a story, I promise you, at some point of profound pain. And if you don't know what to do with pain, it will turn into fear. And we know what fear does. It's the enemy's currency. It will cause you to do stupid things. Cliff wasn't an alcoholic because he was ultimately a bad guy. Cliff wasn't a heroin addict because he was ultimately a bad guy. Cliff was deeply wounded and hurt and broken as a child. I eventually had him come into my garage and I just asked a little bit about him. And in our first conversation, I found out two things about him. One, in the house right next to where we were sitting, he watched his mom die of a heroin overdose when he was a child. And then two, I found out later that the only wife he ever had a few years into being his wife in that same house died of a heroin overdose. And I'm starting to put the pieces together. And I'm starting to get out of peacekeeping safety, keep my family safe mode, and I'm starting to get into peacemaker mode, Jesus mode, which is like, Cliff's like a modern day leper in our neighborhood, but I'm starting to, instead of being afraid to go catch leprosy, I'm starting to go, I think he needs to catch Jesus. And so more often I would start mowing my lawn, and when he would hear that, that was a sign. Come talk to Jude first, and then when I'm done, Cliff, we'll go in the garage, I'll get us some non-alcoholic beverages, and we'll have us a conversation. And we would do that summer for a couple years in a row. We just had our rhythm. He knew if I'm mowing, that means it's Cliff time. And I would ask him questions. Sometimes he'd be drunk, but we'd pray together. Drunk people are fun to pray with, by the way. Peacemaking's not boring. It's fun. Peacekeeping's boring. Peacemaking is a blast. It's going to get you in some trouble. You're going to take some punishment like Jesus did. You're going to be misunderstood, and you're going to be maligned, and people are going to question your motives, and people are going to question who you hang out with sometimes. But peacemaking is fun when you're doing it for the glory of Jesus and you're stirring up holy trouble. And I think this is a room full of people that want to do that. In fact, there's an incredible video of a hero of mine, and his name is Reverend Wade Watts, and he's not alive anymore, but he was an incredible pastor through the 1960s civil rights movements in the Jim Crow South, and he was the leader of the NAACP in the Oklahoma chapter, and he was asked to do a debate with a Grand Dragon of the Ku Klux Klan in Oklahoma, and that's when they first met. And Reverend Wade Watts is the personification of what I'm talking about tonight, what I want you to grab a hold of. He's the ultimate peacekeeper. Watch this video. Remember that name, the Reverend Wade Watts, right? He's the prototype of peacekeeper that I'm trying to explain to you guys. He's showing us what's possible. But here's why I wanted to show you that, because you got to understand something about peacemaking. Peacemaking is a posture before it's a practice. You can't do what Reverend Watts did just because you're feeling froggy and funny. No, you have to be completely at peace with who you are. I would have never preached the message I'm preaching tonight if Pastor Nick and Pastor Louie and Pastor Mike didn't first preach what they preached, which was how we receive peace through the grace and the mercy of the Holy Spirit. Because if you fake peace for very long and go out making holy trouble, it's not going to be very holy. I promise you that. And what we learned from Reverend Watts is I would kill to have met him. I can't wait to meet him in heaven. I would have killed to have met him on this side of eternity to know what that kind of peace looks like. Because to treat somebody that wants to kill you, that fundamentally hates you for nothing more than the color of your skin, that would burn down and try and ruin your church, and you just keep responding back to them with that kind of grace and that kind of mercy, that's the holy troublemaker that I want to be, and I think a bunch of you in this room want to be. That's just my guess, like Reverend Wade Watts. But you got to understand this, and I'm wrapping up. Peace is a posture if it's ever going to be a practice. And the beauty of the peace of Christ, like Pastor Mike and the rest of them so eloquently said, was that it is a gift from the Holy Spirit. And that was what was so beautiful about this conference. Is it was night after night after night after night, God going, I want to pour into you if you'll just receive it as a gift, the Holy Spirit, so that you can be full of my peace. Because when you're full of true peace, there's just something in you that eventually starts getting froggy. Peace was never meant to be hoarded. You understand that? It's the hottest commodity on planet Earth, but it was never meant to be hoarded. Peace is like money, right? Like when God gives it to you, it's to spread it out. That's why James uses the language that peacemakers who sow, sowing's a financial term, right? In the farming industry, that's why they said sow in the scriptures all the time, because it was an agrarian culture, right? And when they said sow, it's throwing seed into the ground. And here's the beautiful thing about being a peacemaker instead of a peacekeeper is there's a return, there's a harvest. Do you know the first sermon that Ku Klux Klan member you heard from preached was in Reverend Watts' church after Reverend Watts led him to Christ? And you know he would spend the rest of his life being a itinerant evangelist, preaching to people? Do you know that Ku Klux Klan member that you heard from to this day calls Reverend Watts his hero and his mentor? All because one man was so at peace with himself that he was able to make that kind of holy trouble. Don't tell me peace doesn't come with power. Come on. Come on. But it's got to be real peace. And God wants to just keep imparting it. into this group of people because he wants us out there, not in here. Can I remind us that when we come to church, that church isn't the football field, it's the locker room? Yeah. I sometimes, because church is so amazing nowadays, we start to think it's actually the game. I mean, we meet in arenas now, right? Like, it can feel like it's the game. But when we come to church, it's the locker room where we come to get refueled, where we come to remember the game plan, where we go when we get hurt to get healed and to get hope and to get help so we can what? Go back out there where the real field is, where we can really make peace. We come here to get peace so we can go out there and be peacemakers, because peacemakers who sow in peace will raise a harvest of righteousness. Man, you guys can go ahead and come on up. You guys have been so kind. I'm wrapping up, but I want to finish by telling you the rest of the story. Cliff was a carpenter by trade, and he rarely got any bids. He would half the time, when he was supposed to go out and get bids, I even sometimes was in charge of going to make sure he was up, because we had accountability talks, and he had just sleep through it. But every now and then, he would get a bid, and I would see him proudly going to work. And he would have the worst jeans, and he would have holes in his boots, and he would have a nasty shirt. And so finally, one day it was like, I want you to fix that, Chad. God said that to my heart. I want you to fix that, Chad. And I'm like, really? I do enough for Cliff. Come on. And God's like, no, you're a peacemaker. You're not a peacekeeper. Go get in it. And I've given you resource to go and be a peacemaker. And you want more peace in Cliff's life? You know what he needs? He needs to go and have a job. So go help him out. And so I said, all right, Cliff, go to work. I said, but you can't dress like this anymore. But we can't fix the problem now, because you got to go to work. So when you get home tonight, if my wife lets me, we're going to dinner, and then we're going to the mall, and we're going to get you some new clothes. If you would have told me a couple years before that I was going to even talk to Cliff ever, more or less now we're going out for dinner together and we're going to the mall to get our shopping on, I would have said that's absolutely impossible. But that's the power of peacemakers. And God did all of it. It wasn't me. I wasn't that good of a person. It was just God that was continually using Cliff to teach me what it's like to be a peacemaker. Because peacemakers who sow in peace will raise a harvest of righteousness. Do you understand? Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers, for they're my real sons and daughters. There's a blessing in peacemaking. I don't see anywhere there's a blessing in peacekeeping, right? There is a blessing that comes. That word in the original language means happy, fortunate, to be envied. But you're going to pay a price to keep peace. And so I took him to the mall. And eventually God says, you know that Suburban he loves to talk to your son in? Give him the car. And I'm like, I need the car and I'm broke. God's like, give him the car. And I had done this dance with God enough and with Cliff enough to know if God wants me to give Cliff the car, I'm giving Cliff the car so he can have a bigger truck to put all of his tools in. And we gave him the car. And by the time we did that, Cliff finally started talking to me about Jesus. Because I tried to defend before I tried to disciple, right? I tried to defend the guy who was defenseless because of his brokenness. And I didn't know I was doing that. God was teaching me. That's why I'm here teaching it now, because God was teaching me. And I defended him before I ever tried to talk to him about Jesus. And then we're sitting in the garage one day and he just loses it and breaks down. And I got to pray with him and I got to tell him the gospel. And I prayed a sinner's prayer with him, and he asked Jesus to forgive him all of his sins. And I told him, it's not about your behavior, it's about the behavior of Jesus on the cross. And there's no sin that is even remotely close to as big as the grace of Jesus and the innocent and divine blood that he shed for you and I on the cross. And I was giving him the whole talk, and I was preaching to him, and I think he was actually even sobering up as I was preaching. And I sat there with Cliff, and I got to pray with him the prayer of salvation, and it was so rewarding and so beautiful. But the story doesn't end there. A couple, 2, 3, 4 months later, I woke up early in the morning, and Cliff was, I thought, back up to his old stuff, because I woke up to red and blue lights flashing around my window pane. And I was like, oh, he got in a fight. Oh, his brother came over and they got in a fight. Oh, Cliff and his dad got in a fight. Oh no, man. And I look out, except this time there's about 8 cops out there. And I'm like, that's a little overkill for Cliff. Usually there's a couple that show up. There's 8 cops out there. And I kept looking for a while, and they were there forever. So I finally started doing something else. And then I came back to see what they were doing. And all of a sudden there was an EMT truck there. And I go, what kind of fight was this? Like, right? And it was taking a while. So I went back and my wife and I kept checking every now and then, and it was probably 2 hours in. And then I'll never forget this seared into my mind. I cracked open the window and I looked back out, and there was two guys wearing coats kind of like this, and they were carrying out a body bag. And I knew my heart just sunk. I knew I'd just lost my friend. I just knew it. I didn't know how, I didn't know what, but I knew I'd lost my friend. And I go running out the door and I find his dad, Chuck. And I go, Chuck, what's going on? And he's shaking, and he's an older man, and he's shaking. He goes, Cliff just took his life. Just took his life. He got one of my old shotguns from the closet and he just took his life. And I just sat there and I just started bawling. And as I look back on that time, I started to realize I wasn't crying because he committed suicide. I was crying because of how hurt my friend was, how much pain my friend was in. He wasn't the ornery drug addict neighbor anymore. He was Cliff, my buddy, my friend. And I felt it for him. But then can I be honest for a minute? And I'm not a theologian, so I'm not up here making declarations about how God works. That's above my pay grade. But I just know, I've just served God long enough to know just how unbelievably good our God is. And I knew from the second that he took his life, I will sit in a garage somewhere in heaven with Cliff someday, and nobody can take that away from me. And I can't wait to see him in heaven. I know that prayer we prayed. I saw it in his eyes. And let me just say this, if that was my only hand of harvest that I got to walk into heaven with, my life's good. I hope there's gonna be a whole bunch more hands that I get to lock with because I chose to be a peacemaker instead of a peacekeeper. But if that was my only hand of harvest that I got to walk into heaven with, I am proud with dignity to walk with Cliff. That's what peacemaking does. It gets you in some awesome trouble. It'll be, I'm about to ask you guys if you want to be peacemakers. And let me just tell you, if you say yes, don't be surprised when Cliff comes into your life. Don't be surprised when you move in next to Cliff. Don't be surprised when that verse, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, keeps popping up everywhere you go. Keeps getting preached about every sermon you hear. Don't be surprised when radical kingdom type stuff starts happening when you say, I want to be a peacemaker. Don't be surprised when people start judging you for the people you hang out with. Don't be surprised when people misunderstand your heart for the marginalized. Don't be surprised when you stick up for a people group that deserves you sticking up for them and the other people group doesn't like it. Because all of that stuff's going to happen, but you just have to calmly say to yourself, oh, bless their hearts, they're peacekeepers. That's not my crew, I'm a peacemaker. And peacekeepers got a lot of time on their hands to wonder what everyone else is doing that are peacemakers. And I don't know about you, I want to be in the peacemaking category, not the peacekeeper category. I don't want to sit around and have enough time on my hands to question why everybody hangs out with them or treats those people so nice or fights for those people's rights like they fight for those people's rights. I want to be like Reverend Watts, people. I want to have so much of God's peace on the inside, so much understanding of who he says I am in Christ, that I see people for who they are. I see beyond their brokenness and I see their story. I see their soul. And I know you do too. But that takes guts and that takes courage. And that's exactly what Christ died to leave us with, peace and courage. So if you guys would stand, I'm going to finish by praying for y'all. And I just want to ask this question with everybody's head up and everybody's eyes open. Because we're the church. If you're in here tonight and at any point God was speaking to you and saying, you're a peacemaker. You're not passive. You're not scared. You're courageous more than you even think. And I want to send you to people that are going to inconvenience you. And I want to send you to people that you never thought you'd want to hang out with. And I want to ask you to do some things that are going to cost you on the front end and completely bless you on the back end. I'm going to ask you to pay some things now so you can play later. Are you willing to do that? Because that's what peacemakers do. But listen, peacemakers who sow in peace will raise a harvest of righteousness. It's the sweet spot. Blessed are the peacemakers, so they shall be the sons and daughters of God. So if you're in here and you say, you know what, I am a little nervous because I understand that it comes with some problems, but I really want to be that person. I want to take the peace that the Holy Spirit has planted on the inside of me, and I want to disperse it to the world for the betterment of this place. I want to be a person that brings heaven to earth. If that's you, would you boldly put your hand up right now, because we're going to pray for each other. I got my hand up. I want to be that. Come on, hands all over the place. Hands all over the place. Hands all over the place. If your hand's not up, first of all, I admire your honesty. Second of all, that probably means you deserve a peacemaker in your life. And we pray for you, and we love you, and God loves you, and he's going to somehow, some way, get you to the point where you actually want to be that. But for everyone whose hands up, God, I pray in the name of Jesus that you would pour strength, and I pray in the name of Jesus that you would pour power, and I pray in the name of Jesus that you would give us a holy courage to go start some stuff as the body of Christ. I pray, Father God, that you would give us a holy discontentment for the status quo. God, I pray that Lakewood young adults would be anything but peacekeepers, that this would be a room constantly full of peacemakers who go out into their communities and into their homes and into their jobs and look for somebody that they can go and make peace with. God, give us the guts, give us the grace, give us the favor, and give us the courage. We pray this, Jesus, in the name that is above every name. And all of my friends and family at Lakewood said, amen. I love you guys.
Can you just stay right where you're at? No one moving if you can. I know many people, you might have a kid checked in, you need to head out, but can we just bow our heads and close our eyes? I want to do one more thing. And maybe, regardless if your hand was lifted or not, I know there's a lot of people watching online right now, but I believe this is a moment for many of you to step into a relationship with the only one that can give you true peace for your soul. It's hard to describe. The Bible says that God's peace surpasses our understanding. But something powerful takes place when you choose to receive the grace of God into your life for yourself. I'm not talking about religion. I'm not talking about being a good person. I'm talking about coming to Jesus as you are, knowing you're not in right relationship with him, and to say, I want his grace, and I want the life he's designed for me to live. You may have been to church before, but you've yet to make this step of faith. You've yet to surrender your heart. I'm not talking about chasing and running anymore. I'm talking about coming to Jesus, leaving here with peace, and you can rest. With every head bowed, every eye closed, I'm going to count down from three. When I get to one, if you want to give Jesus Christ your life tonight, or you want to recommit your heart to him, when I get to one, I want you to real boldly slip your hand up and say, that's me. I want to come home to grace. I want to leave here with a new beginning. I'm tired of chasing purpose and peace and all these other things. I'm coming home to my maker, my creator. Three. No one looking around. Two, if you want to give your life to Christ or rededicate. One, I want you to put your hand up real boldly tonight. Come on, hands are up all over the house. Hands are up everywhere. Wow, incredible. On the sides, front, back. Okay, you can put your hands down. You can look up at me. Hands everywhere. So this is what we're going to do. It's my favorite part of every Sunday night, every moment we gather together, because it's people stepping into what Jesus went to the cross for. He paid the price so that people tonight could encounter his love and grace and leave here different, with hope, with purpose, with peace. So if you lifted your hand, or even if you didn't, I'm gonna ask you to do something bold. Jesus says, if you won't be ashamed of me in front of man on earth, I won't be ashamed of you before our Father in heaven someday. I'm gonna give you a great opportunity to show Jesus that you're unashamed. If you want peace, if you wanna make Jesus the Lord of your life, if you raise your hand, or even if you didn't, maybe a friend will come with you, maybe a leader will come with you, or maybe you're just bold enough to come by yourself. Right now, if you want to receive Jesus, I want you to step out of your seat, step out of your row, and come and meet me right now in front of this platform, and I want to lead you in a prayer to receive peace from heaven, to receive joy, to receive grace that your soul needs. Come on, church, can we celebrate every bold person that's stepping out right now in faith to receive a new beginning? Come on, if you lifted your hand, or even if you didn't, and you want to come home to Jesus, you want to come home to purpose, come on, maybe a friend will come down here with you. Maybe a leader who saw your hand will say, hey, I'll help you get peace. I'll walk down there with you. Come on, if you saw someone around you and you want to make that step with them, go ahead and invite them to come. Incredible. Come on, anybody else want to receive peace from their maker tonight? Come on, people are still coming. Come on, people are still coming. Keep clapping. Make room, make room, make room. You got to scoot up just a little bit. Amazing. Anyone else on the sides, way in the back? We got plenty of time for this moment. So amazing. We're so proud of you. I can't even begin to describe how incredible this moment is and what it can be for you in your life. Because it's beyond just a prayer of faith in this moment. It's something that changes everything from the inside out and propels you to a life that God's designed for you to live. All along, this is what God's designed for you to walk in. His peace and His love and His grace. I don't know what people have told you. I don't know what religion has told you. But tonight can be a new beginning for you. And you can walk out of here because of what Jesus did for you. You can walk out of here fresh, new, alive in Jesus. Can you bow your heads? Can we all bow our heads and close our eyes? If you've come down here, or even if you didn't, or if you're watching online, you want to make Jesus the Lord of your life. I want you to repeat this simple prayer of faith after me and say it with passion. Repeat after me. Say, Jesus, I stand before you tonight and I ask you to forgive me of all my mistakes and all of my sins. Come into my heart. Come into my life and wash me clean. Tonight I choose to make you my Lord and my Savior. I want to live my life for you and only you. I want to be a peacemaker. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, church, can we celebrate with heaven? Amazing. So proud of y'all. So proud. Listen, if you prayed that prayer or you came down, I want to encourage you with one thing, and that's this. The Bible says that the righteous fall seven times, but they get back up. Pastor Chad preached about it throughout his message. We fall as believers, but we get back up in grace, we turn from our mistake, and we chase after the purpose that God has for our lives. Following Jesus long haul is not being about, it's not about being perfect. It's about getting really good at getting back up in His grace, turning and going after the purpose that He has for your life. Don't let the voices of the enemy, the condemnation and guilt, keep you in your past, keep you in your mistake. Jesus, His power is bigger. His grace is bigger than any mistake. You walk out of here with a new beginning. Other thing I'll say, if you look over to your right, my left, you'll see Terry Williams. He's one of our finest leaders and staff members here at Lakewood. He wants to take 2 minutes to give you a Bible if you don't have one, some resources that will help you in your journey. I'm going to step out there in a moment as well, and I would love to meet you. I would love to visit with you for a moment as well, and they'll help you get some resources that will get you on. Take 2 minutes of your time, and then you can dip out and do whatever you got to do tonight. But Lakewood Church, as they head out, can we just celebrate them? You can go ahead and follow Terry, and I'll step out there in a minute and meet you as well. Come on, let's give them a big welcome home celebration as they go. Proud of y'all. Proud of y'all. Come on, church, celebrate them as they go. Never get tired of this moment. Never get tired of clapping your hands and cheering for so many people that are stepping into a powerful new beginning. It's why we do what we do. Amazing, amazing, amazing. Hey, can we thank Pastor Chad Bruegman from coming from Denver, Colorado to invest such a timely word? Shake us up a little bit. Let's be peacemakers this week, amen? Let's go make peace. It's gonna get uncomfortable. But let's see more people in here next Sunday night because you chose to be a peacemaker. So peace. Torrin Wells will be speaking next Sunday night. So I hope you can bring 10 people back with you. We're going to step into this next season with great faith and great expectation. Amen? Let me leave you with a blessing before you leave. Numbers chapter 6. May the Lord bless you and may the Lord keep you. May the Lord show you His favor and have mercy on you. And may the Lord watch over you and give you His peace. We love you so much. Have a great week. We'll see you next Sunday night.